of you my what is she saying? Yeah, so anyway, I thank God for this time. Let us just bow our heads in prayer right now. Let's commit this time to the Lord. Father, once again, we just want to humble our lives. We humble ourselves before you this morning. I pray, Father God, that you open our hearts and our minds to your presence, to your word, to your Holy Spirit. God, even as we come here this morning, it is because we want to worship you. We want to hear from you, God. And so, Lord, I pray that even as we dedicate this time to listening to your word, God, I pray that you open our hearts, you open our spiritual minds, Father God, to hear you. We want to hear you, Lord, speaking to us, that, Lord, you will speak to us your message today. And I pray, Father God, that you bless my lips, Father God. Anoint my lips, Lord, to be your mouthpiece today. We commit this time, we commit your word into your hands. We commit every hearer. I commit every hearer, God, even for those probably who is listening online. I pray, Father God, that you touch every single one of us with your precious hand. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. So today is the week after the Resurrection Sunday, right? And I know that Easter Sunday is one of the very highlights, one of the highlights for us Christians. Aside from Christmas, the Resurrection Sunday, the Easter Sunday, the Sunday where our Lord Jesus Christ, we commemorate his rising from the dead, is one of the most important events or occasions that we celebrate as Christians. And in fact, I know that where I came, the church where I came from before, it's a very big deal. It's a whole month of celebration, beginning from, if I remember, Ash Wednesday, where they will put the ash, like, you know. And it's a whole month also of fasting. We abstain ourselves from eating all those nice food. We don't eat meat. There's a lot of pantang. I don't know from where I came from in the Philippines. We cannot eat panggang food because they say, what, we become black or something like that, you know. So there's a lot of things that we cannot do, especially after Friday. After Good Friday, Saturday, we cannot go out of the house because it's dangerous, they said. Because Jesus is dead. So nobody will jaga you. Nobody will look after you. You might go into an accident or something untoward may happen to you because the Lord is dead. But thankfully, for us, we don't believe that. Yes, probably 2,000 years ago, that happened. But our Lord, we are serving a risen God, right? We are serving a risen Savior. He is alive. And so we don't need to be afraid to go out. Even though, because we are just remembering, we are just commemorating what the Lord has done for us. Okay, so today is the first Sunday after the Resurrection Sunday. And I know, like what I said, in many churches, the Holy Week is a very big deal. In fact, usually in many churches, Easter Sunday is a big celebration. There's a lot of preparation. Probably the church, especially in big churches, they will have a special presentation. There will be a choir. There will be a presentation from the children, probably from the youth. They will have a skit. Probably it will be an evangelistic meeting, because that's one of the very good reasons, very good opportunity to witness to the world, those who has not yet come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, to invite them and hear the message. And so a lot of preparation probably, you know, for the drama, the skit and whatever, the choir, whatever. And so everybody is busy, everybody is excited for Easter Sunday. And today is, Easter is finished. Easter is gone. And we are like back to normal, right? So my message this morning is, what happened after Easter? May I remind us that just because Easter is gone, Easter is finished, that the Lord Jesus is also gone. Probably in other churches, if they have invited a speaker, the guest speaker has already gone, he has gone home, but not our Lord. Easter is already berlalu, is gone, but the Lord is still around. Easter is gone, the Resurrection Sunday is finished, is over, but the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ and your ministry and my ministry is not yet over. Amen? Okay, so this morning I would like us to turn to John chapter 21, the Gospel of John. That's the last chapter of the Gospel of John. Okay, are you there? John chapter 21. Let's read from verse 1. In fact, it's quite a long one, so let's just probably read until 19. Okay? Let's take the time to read the Word of God. Okay? Are you there? Okay. John chapter 21, let's read. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and in this way he showed himself. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We are going with you also." They went out and immediately got into a boat. And that night, what? They caught nothing. But when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "Children," in some translations it says, "friends, have you any food?" Or in some translations it says, "Have you caught any fish?" To which they answered, "No." And he said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast. And now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and he plunged into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land, but about 200 cubits, dragging the net with fish. Then, as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, and fish laid on it, and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish which you have just caught." Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land, full of large fish. How many? 153. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. Let's continue reading. Verse 12. Jesus said to them, "Come and eat breakfast." Yet none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus then came and took the bread and gave it to them, and likewise the fish. This is now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than this?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him again a second time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." Verse 17, he said to him the third time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." And then in verse 19, this he spoke, signifying what the death he would glorify God, referring to Simon Peter. And when he had spoken, he said this to him, "Follow me." Okay. This morning, there are a few things that I would like to highlight to us, and I hope that we can pick some lessons from here. Like what I said, the Resurrection Sunday is over, but our mission is not over. Easter is gone, the guest speaker is gone, but the Lord is not gone. He has not gone away. He is still here with us through His Holy Spirit. Now, what happened to the apostles was that even though the Lord Jesus, the text where we have read, the Lord Jesus appeared to them how many times now? Third time. But it does not mean that Jesus was like, when before he died, that Jesus was with them 24/7. He was no longer, after the resurrection, Jesus would just suddenly appear to them. He was not with them the whole 24 hours anymore. He will just come suddenly without announcing, without informing them that "I am coming. Tonight in your prayer meeting, I'm coming." No, he will just suddenly come. And he comes even though the doors were closed. Because the Lord Jesus Christ was already in his resurrected body. It is no longer the mortal body, but he was already clothed with the immortal body. That's why he is able to tumbus even though through the wood or the cement or bricks. Amen? And so, because the Lord Jesus Christ was no longer with the disciples 24 hours like what he used to, Peter, being always the action man, action not action yang in Sabah we interpret the word action as very proud. But he is the person who is always active. He wants to do something. Yeah, he cannot sit down. And because Jesus is no longer with them 24/7, he will just muncul tiba-tiba. So he thought, probably our ministry finished already lah. The Lord Jesus, don't know where he is already. He didn't give us any instructions. So, don't know what to do. We need to eat. No more income. No supply. Jesus no longer here to supply us bread. So he said, "I'm going fishing." Remember that Peter and most of his disciples were fishermen. Before they left the fishing business to follow the Lord, they were fishermen. And so, of course, the logical thing to do if they you want to go back and earn some money is for you to go back to your former business, right? And so that is what happened to Peter. He said, "No more food to eat. I have a family to feed, so I'm going fishing. And the rest of his friends said, we will follow you. Okay? And so they went fishing. And what did the verse say? The whole night they were fishing. And yet, they caught kosong. They caught nothing. With all their might, with all their ability as a professional fishers, they did with all their ability, with all the foreman knowledge that they have. They probably know where the best fishing ground is. They went there. They went that way. But yet, the whole night that they tried, they caught nothing. And of course, we can understand that most probably they were very tired. They were hungry, right? For those of you, especially the young people, I know, if you are up the whole night, probably by midnight, by 1 o'clock, you're hungry already, right? You will be looking for food. And so we can understand that probably the disciples, how many of them? I kira, there were 7 of them. 7 hungry people, sleepy people in the morning. And then suddenly, from the beach, somebody shouted at them, hey, friends, guys, any fish? It's like adding, rubbing, what? Salt to insult. And so they couldn't even be bothered to look at who the guy was calling to them. And they said, none. Nothing, kosong. And then the guy said, they didn't recognize him, right? The Bible says, they didn't recognize who it was that was telling them, asking them, got any fish or not? You caught any fish or not? Even ikan bilis, kosong. Satu ikan bilis pun kosong. And the guy, the person who talked to them said, throw your net at the right side. At the right side. Probably they were trying to fish at the wrong side the whole night. Okay? And so, even though they were tired, they were hungry, they tried their best, they obeyed. And so these are the things that I want us to catch this morning. First one is that they didn't recognize who it was. They didn't recognize who it was talking to them. Why was that? It's quite kind of weird because they had been with the Lord Jesus Christ prior to this for more than 3 years. They ate with him, they talked with him, they slept together, they ministered together, they served together, they walked together, and yet they didn't recognize him. Probably because, like what I said, they couldn't even be bothered to look who was that talking to them, and that's why they didn't recognize him. And also probably they were not expecting him to be at the shore. Probably they were just expecting him, maybe prayer meeting lah, like what he did in the previous appearance. That suddenly they were gathered together and Jesus appeared to them during their prayer meeting. So they were not probably expecting Jesus to be at the shore that morning, early morning some more. They said, maybe, still sleeping. Oh, pastor still sleeping early morning. Okay, so they were not expecting. Sometimes we also, when we don't look for the presence of God, for the work of God in our situation, we would not recognize that Jesus is in fact with us in our circumstances, in our situation, because we were not expecting. expecting. We are not expectant. Sometimes we come to church, out of obligation, out of routine. You don't really expect God to move, to speak to you, or to touch you. You know, because probably we just come to church out of routine, out of obligation. Because I'm supposed to be a good Christian, so I must come to church. But you are not really expecting God to move in your behalf. And so sometimes if we are not careful, if we are not watchful, Jesus is actually there, the presence of God is there, and yet we don't recognize it. And we miss the opportunity of the blessing of God working on our behalf. Now, secondly, we are to obey His instructions. Okay? Even though thankfully they obeyed Jesus' instructions. Probably if it was me, if I'm one of the disciples, fishing, trying to catch fish the whole night, tired, hungry, sleepy. If somebody, I don't know, the Bible says, right, that at first they didn't recognize him. If that guy said, "You try one more time, on the right side. Throw your net on the right side." And actually, they have already come near to the beach. I would probably say, "Ayah, tidak payahlah, no need lah. I've enough, tired already, cukup. I've tried my best the whole night, no catch. How to catch fish now? We are near the shore already, near the beach already." Probably that would be my reaction. But thankfully, the disciples obeyed the Lord's instructions. They throw their net at the right side, and what happened? Even though they were near the beach already, yet they caught what? Small fish? Large fish. Large fish, usually you have to go to the deep, right? But because they obeyed the instructions of the Lord, they were blessed. Hallelujah. They had a miraculous catch of fish. And we know that there was a witness. They were witnesses. We know that the account in the Bible is true because of the number. They kira. They counted how many fishes there was. How many? 153 large fishes. Hallelujah. It was a miraculous catch. It was a miraculous provision. Hallelujah. And so we learn today, irregardless of how we feel, irregardless of our doubts, our fears, our tiredness, you know, obey the Lord's instructions. If you want to be blessed, obey the Lord's command. Amen. Hallelujah. Next is that we rest in His provision. Rest in His provision. Like what I said, they were tired, they were hungry, they were sleepy. And when they came to the shore, They found what? Food, breakfast ready for them. There was already fish, panggang fish and bread ready for them. Hallelujah. God understands our need. God understands our situation. He is such a loving master. He is a loving God, a loving Savior. He is not a hard master, but a loving, a concerned master. He knew His people, the disciples, were tired. He knew that they needed refreshing. He knew that they were hungry. And so, wow. Imagine the God of heaven, the God of the universe, the God who created the whole world made breakfast, special service for them. What a Savior, what a Lord, what a Master, what a good God He is. That's why we sing, God is so good. In fact, I should say, God is not just good, God is best. Because in English, there is this, how do you call that? It's supposed to be good, and then better, and then best. So good is paling bawa kan? So God is not just good, God is best. it's wrong grammar probably, but to me, God is not just good, God is the best. Hallelujah. Amen. God is the best. And His provision is always enough. Amen. Not just enough, probably more than enough. The Lord provided to them in many ways in these incidents. God did not just provide, the Lord did not just provide a good harvest, rather good haul of fish, 153 large fishes, so much so that their nets nearly broke. But thankfully it didn't break. Oh, if not, the fish will lari already. Oh, sayang. But that is also another miracle, that God kept their nets intact so that their blessings will be contained. It will not be wasted. Okay? And so, firstly, God provided, like what I said, more than enough, in that God has given them a miraculous haul of catch of fish, 153 large ones. And secondly, God provided for them their breakfast. We would wonder, where did Jesus get the fish? What? We don't know where He got the fish from. He didn't go out fishing. Where did He go get the charcoal? Where did He get fire? For men, probably that time they don't have lighter. And men who has lighter usually are the people yang smoking, right? Jesus is not smoking. He's not a smoker. Don't know where He get the light from, the fire from. Oh, so it was even that itself is a miracle. Don't know where He get the charcoal. Don't know where He get the fire. Oh, don't know where He get the bread and the fish. Yeah. The breakfast was not a kingly spread, not probably like Jamie Oliver ka, or what Gordon Ramsay or Chef Wan punya kind of breakfast. But it is enough. Hallelujah. It was a loving gesture from God that God provided for His disciples, for His people. So we need to rest in the provision of God. We need to be thankful for the provision of God. I remembered Elijah. Remember Elijah? After he had this contest with the false prophets of Baal, and he killed all the prophets of Baal in Mount Carmel. I remember the name Mount Carmel because that's where my name comes from. Yeah, Carmelita. Okay, so after that, the queen Jezebel wanted his head, Elijah's, the prophet's head. She wanted to kill him. And so, kasiano, the prophet Elijah, he is such, you can see him, such a powerful man, such a brave person. But with the lady, he was so scared. He ran away. Because of a lady, he ran away. The brave, the courageous prophet Elijah ran away because of Queen Jezebel, who wanted his life. And so God told him to go to the mountain near the creek, and he was fed by the bird, the raven. Raven to the Jews is an unclean bird, and yet God provided food for the prophet Elijah through the raven. That's why I said we need to rest in the provision of God. We accept God's provision. Because if not, Elijah could have starved. You know why? Because if he echoed his beliefs, he would not have received the meat that the bird brought in his mouth to feed him. Because in his ajaran, he would think that, how can I receive food from this bird, because this bird is an unclean bird. Don't know where he got the meat from. Yeah? And yet God provided food for Elijah throughout that drought, through the raven. It was not what he probably liked, but he was thankful. It was enough for him to survive the whole time that there was drought. And after the drought, when the creek, the supply of the water, no more, the creek dried up, that's when God again instructed him to go and find the widow. And that's where God continued to provide for him. And so, for us, probably we are praying, God, I need a car. Probably God will not provide a Lamborghini, BMW, or a Mercedes. Probably God will give you, a conchil? Be thankful for it. Amen? Or an Exia, the car my daughter is driving. Be thankful for God's provision. Amen? Yeah, it is enough. Asal can bring me here and there, cukup. No, for me, no need to be an expensive watch. Asal, it's the same time, but whether it's what Omega, what Rolex watch, it's still the same time, ba? Kan? As long can pakai. I mean, there are some people they don't want to buy. I don't want to buy. How do you call that? A small car. If I want to buy a car, it must be the 100 plus figure one. No need lah. As long as can bring you here and there, cukup lah. Okay? Live within our means. Yeah? Live within our means. Hallelujah. That is also about good stewardship. If the Lord blesses you with more than when you can afford, yes, why not? Amen? But whatever God provided for you at that time, be thankful. It is enough. Hallelujah. Another thing that we can learn from here is that the last point, actually, that I want us to learn from here is that we need to return to the purpose of God. We need to return to the purpose of God. For Peter, like what I said, he lari from his calling. Earlier in the ministry, the Lord told Peter in Luke, there was a parallel story about this miraculous catch of fish in Luke chapter 5. You can read it later, you know, where they also... how do you call that? They went fishing the whole night and also caught nothing. And the same thing, the Lord Jesus appeared to them and said, throw your net to the other side and you will catch some. This time also they had a very large catch of fish. So much so that their nets were about to break already. And so they had to call their other partners. Hey, come, help. Our net going to break already. Better put some in your boat. Huh? And that is why when the Lord Jesus did this same thing again, this miracle again, then John remembered and he told Peter, it is the Lord. Because John remembered what happened in Luke chapter 5 earlier in the ministry, that Jesus said the same thing. And they caught a large catch of fish. And that is why they remember. That's why also it is important when we pray, when we ask something from the Lord, to record it. Have a journal how the Lord answered your prayer so that you can look back. You have a record of how the Lord worked in your situation. Not only that, we also have the Word of God, the Bible, as a reference. And that is why they said, ah, it must be Jesus because he did this the last time. So it must be the Lord. Okay? And so, after that, Jesus told Peter, you will no longer be fishing fish, but you will be a fisher of men. And so, Peter left that business and he followed the Lord. But then, after Easter, after that Resurrection Sunday, because like what I said, Jesus was no longer there with them 24 hours, 7 days a week. Jesus will just munchul suddenly, tiba-tiba. And so, that's why Peter thought that their ministry is gone, is finished. And so he went back fishing. And this time around, Jesus restored him to his calling, to the purpose that God has called him. Okay? And so, before that, Jesus had to restore him. After Jesus fed them with a warm breakfast, Jesus called Peter aside. And the Lord asked him three times. Why do you think Jesus asked him three times, Peter, do you love me? Probably because how many times did Peter deny the Lord? Three times, right? And so probably that's why Jesus also had to ask him, Peter, do you really love me? Do you really love me? Do you really love me? And Peter was grieved in his heart. Lord, you know. Probably at that time also, Peter must be feeling ashamed and guilty because it's just baru ba, just 1 week ago ba, when he denied the Lord. It was still very fresh. And so when he encountered the Lord this time, some more with the charcoal burning. Remember when Peter denied the Lord, he was also warming himself at the charcoal fire where the maid and the people that was surrounding them asked him, are you also one of the followers? Because your accent the same as his. Are you also a Galilean, a follower of this Jesus? Said, no, I never knew him. And probably that image, that picture of the charcoal burning them there must have brought that into his memory. That was the situation though, where I denied the Lord. The Lord had to ask him, do you love me more than this? I don't know. We don't know who the Lord is referring to about the this here. Do you love me more than this? Whether he was referring to the other disciples or he was referring to the big catch of fish. Do you love me more than this fish and what it represents? It represents money, right? Income. Do you love me more than this blessing? Or do you love me? Okay, probably. These are the options that we can think of. And Peter said, Lord, you know that I love you. And so the Lord Jesus gently reminded him of his calling. Remember what the Lord says in Jeremiah. For I know, can you quote? For I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you, to give you a hope and a future. Peter and the other disciples thought that they don't have any more hope because Jesus is gone. Easter and resurrection is gone. Ministry is finished. It's gone. No hope. So better go back to our old way of living. But Jesus reminded them about the promise of God. God says, I know the plans I have for you to prosper you, give you a hope and a bright future. So don't go back to your old way of life. You went fishing. That is an example of doing your own way, your old life. You will end up with nothing, kosong. And so God restored him, not only Peter, but the rest of the disciples who were with him. God restored them to the calling and the purpose of God for their lives. And so even for us this morning, probably we lari a bit. Lord, can I lari a bit? Sikijap? Can I do my own thing first? God is telling us this morning, return. Go back. Go back to the calling and the purpose of God that He has for you. Return because God's plan is always for us, a good plan to prosper us, to give us a hope and a future. Hallelujah. Easter is gone. The resurrection is Sunday is gone. It's over. But God is still with us. His provision, His blessing, His presence is still here with us. Amen. And that is the message that I want us to learn from this story this morning. Hallelujah. And so, let's just come to the Lord this morning. And let's just tell the Lord, God, heal my heart. Bring my heart back to you. Lord, I want to recognize your presence in my situation, whatever situation may be in this morning. Bring it to the Lord. Expect God to move on your behalf. Expect God to bring His miraculous provision for you. Whether you need healing, you need direction, let God move on your behalf. This morning, as we sing this song, Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. Let my heart be renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And let's expect God to move us, that our spirit will soar with the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's dedicate our lives to the Lord this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. Renewed, flowing from the grave. morning, we just want to bless you and thank you. We can never thank you enough, Father God, for the goodness that you have shown to us by sending your very own Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to die for us. And because of that sacrifice, because of what you have done on the cross for us, Lord Jesus, heaven's gates is open. Heaven's riches is now made available for us. Your presence, your provision, your protection is for us. You are for us. You are not against us. Amen. Thank you, Lord, that in spite of our failings, in spite of our weaknesses, like what you did, the mercy, the grace that you extended to Peter, Father God, by restoring him to your purposes. You did not shame him. You did not scold him. You were not angry with him. But you restored him gently, lovingly. Thank you, God. This morning, Lord, I just pray that we will continue to bring that realization that you are for us as we leave this place of worship. We will bring with us this knowledge that you are with us. Amen. You are for us.
Yes.
Your provision, abundant, miraculous provision, is for us, is ready for us, for our asking. Your miracle, oh God, is just a prayer away. Hallelujah. You said, Lord, ask and it shall be given. Knock and the door will be opened. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, that we will go out knowing this, that you are always with us. You are always with us. Your provision, your protection, your presence goes with us. Hallelujah. Lord, even as we dismiss from this place, let the glory of the Lord be upon your people. That wherever they go, whatever they will do throughout this week, may they glorify your name. Yes, Lord. By your strength, by your anointing, I commit them to you. They are yours, Lord. We are yours. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Let us give Pastor Carmelita a clap. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. We thank you. Thank you, Pastor Carmelita. Hallelujah. Now, church, before we dismiss this morning, let us just support Pastor Carmelita's ministry. And we just want to thank her for ministering to us this morning. We will collect another offering. Yeah. We just want to thank her for the beautiful words and the beautiful word of God that she has brought to us. A reminder to us what happens after Easter. You know, it is just so powerful because, you know, everybody will just be talking about what happens on that day. But, you know, what happens after, nobody really talks about, you know. So this morning, we just want to give our love and our offerings to her. Let us just bow our head as we prepare. All right. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for your word this morning, Father, that as you remind us, Father God, that you are always here with us, Father, that you never leave us, Father God. Lord, we just want to thank you, Lord, for that reminder and for your love, Father, that is always around us, that is always within us. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy, Father. Hallelujah, Lord. And this morning, as we prepare our hearts and our offerings to bless your work, to bless your pastor, Father, just bless, Lord, use this offering, Father God, for the extension of your works and the extension of your kingdom. Father, I pray that your heavens will be open and it will shower upon us, Father. We thank you, Lord. We bless your holy name, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, church, as you give. And as you give, you can consider yourself dismissed. All right. Let us enjoy our lunch, our makan. Okay. And we will see you again next week. God bless you. Amen.